fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a Warcaster. Take control of the mighty Jacks, arcane devices, and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com. Progress comes to a world of magic as science and the arcane combine to make marvels. Meet steampunk inventors and orc mystics at the Volsung Hub on beastofwar.com.
Good morning, gamers. Welcome to your weekly dose of all things gaming. Right, we have a doozy of a show for you this morning. We're going to be, our big feature is a big, big talk all about Dropfleet.
I can't wait.
Justin and John are going to sit down with Dave, and Dave is in this show, is going to talk about the background and talk about Dropfleet itself.
Yep.
He's then going to show off some painted miniatures. And then for you backstagers, we have a real treat for you tomorrow in the extra long version of this show, or the other alternative version of this show, where we're going to be showing off all the sprues and things like that. This show's great. Tomorrow's show is unbelievable.
And you get to find out why the beard is missing tomorrow.
Yeah, you'll find out about Justin's missing beard tomorrow.
I had a boo-boo.
There's a story to tell in that. Right, before we get stuck into the show, I think we have some contest winners announced.
We do. We were giving away 5 prizes from Miniature Wargaming, the movie, which was on Kickstarter.
Which successfully funded.
Yes, but yeah, we had 5 prizes to give away. So we had 2 DVDs, 2 Blu-rays, and 1 special edition to give away.
We've
now picked those winners.
Yeah.
Our first winner who is getting a DVD is Mind Robber from BOW.
Well done.
Our second winner is Limburger, who is also getting a DVD.
Mm-hmm.
Blu-ray winner, we have Simon
James. That's from BOB, Beast of War as well,
yep.
Limburger, yep.
Our next winner is from Facebook. Simon James Swan has won a Blu-ray copy of it.
Well done.
Our next winner is from YouTube, and it's Master Dwellin.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, for the special edition, which
that's
is...
That's a whole big heap of stuff, isn't it?
That's the one where you get the movie,
yeah,
and I believe you get some extra miniatures. Yeah, Ben?
Yes, that's the one, mm-hmm. Yeah.
The winner of that is Duster from BOW.
Awesome. Congratulations, guys.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a competition reminder for you as well, because at the moment we have a Weird World War battle report, so how to play Konflikt 47, and commenters on that video can be in with a chance of winning a Konflikt 47 starter set.
Yeah, so their choice of the American or the German starter set.
Awesome.
Also, tomorrow morning we will be announcing the winner of the 2-player starter bundle, which we were giving away from last week's show.
Yes. So if you're watching this, become a backstager and look at last week's backstage episode,
yeah,
of the Weekender, and you'll see what we're talking about.
Yeah.
On the topic of winning in competitions and stuff like that,
mm-hmm,
remember, we are now at the halfway point of the Scatter Terrain Challenge. So basically, it's just a big hobby challenge over the summer to create some bits of scatter terrain and to go into the Beast of War forums and kind of blog about it, you know, just
post show your stuff off.
Yeah, post your stuff, post how you're doing it, post what you're doing, and everybody's getting involved. It's been fabulous. The response has been fabulous, but you still have loads of time. Now's a very good time if you want to just kick back and make some terrain, mm-hmm, to come on and get involved in that, because we have some prizes. We have some 50 quid gift vouchers,
yep,
from our partner Foreground, who are involved in this.
Yeah, we have 4 categories, and each winner from each of the 4 categories will get a 50 quid voucher.
Let me recap the categories for you. So we have the best scatter terrain idea. So that's all about, was the idea good? It doesn't matter how well you executed it. It's just, was the idea cool? Mm. Best project log in the forums. So that's more about how good you did the whole showing people how it was done. So it's all about, you know, did you create a good project blog? Best executed entry. In that instance, we don't care about the idea. We just care about how well executed the idea was.
So basically, coolest piece at the end.
Yeah. And then finally, we have best junior beast. So if you're 16 or under, you can let us know in the thing and you'll be entered into that category.
Yeah.
Now, judging will be by some Beast of War crew and the amazing Terrainaholic. Mm-hmm. And the terrain guy.
Yeah, terrain shooter.
Terrain shooter, sorry. Mel, he's the terrain guy to me. So
yeah,
the terrain shooter.
And
yeah,
I believe we have one of the guys from Foreground jumping on board as well to judge.
We have one of the guys from Foreground jumping on.
Yeah.
Do you want to see some of the stuff that's come in so far? Will we do a little preview just to get a gist of what people are doing?
All right, well, who's our first one here, Ben?
Okay, so yeah, the first thing we're going to be looking at is one of the topics by Pete Bick, and this is his really interesting tutorial where he's looking at developing some fantastic industrial walls and fences for you to use in your sci-fi games and stuff like that. Now, these are quite simple things, but they look really cool, and I like the idea of putting more cool pieces of sort of like line-of-sight blocking turret down to the table. Yeah. So this was really nice to check out. So,
This was what it was all about, is this kind of... this kind of terrain. You know, lots of little simple pieces that you would just chuck on a table, any kind of table, you know, and it start to give you lots of options terrain-wise. And I've got to say, I'm a big fan of where he's been going with those, with the fences, and I think the walls look lovely.
Yeah, well, you see, the walls are a great thing because, yes, you could set down four big buildings, but then you just have four big gaps between. Yeah. You're then going to have to fill with something. So having those walls, it lets you cordon off parts of your table a lot better. Yeah.
Next up, we've got some rocky outcrops. So would you check these ones out, Ben?
Yeah, so these ones by Matt Igis, and he was doing some cool stuff that you could use in fantasy. And of course, this kind of stuff would go well with basically any kind of genre you were looking for. So this, again, was something that was really simple and really easy to put together. So it was the basic, you know, bases and stuff that you've
biscuits,
seen before
we
from
call
other
them.
Companies.
Yeah, me and Lloyd call, if you scroll up, Justin, this is what me and Lloyd call biscuits. Mm. And the way we did this is you get hardboard, and you can buy sheets of hardboard. It's dirt cheap. A couple of pounds buys a big sheet of hardboard like this.
Yeah.
Okay. You can use what he's used, a coping saw, or if you're lucky enough to have one, there's a hacksaw. It's like a junior hacksaw there, but you can get a coping saw, which will get in the
those things are a little
angles.
Bit of a pain to use sometimes.
Yeah. We used a thing called a scroll saw, right, which is like a powered coping saw that allows you to move it around and get the shapes.
Yeah, so it's not like a bandsaw, it's just a little blade that just jumps
it's
up and down.
It's a little blade. It's like a little tiny, tiny, thin hacksaw blade, and it just goes like that. Scroll saws, you know, they can be kind of pricey, but, you know, it's...
Yeah, but it depends how much you really want them.
A club could probably afford to go out and band together between them. And pick up a scroll saw.
I don't know. If you're picking up like a B&Q band or a B&Q brand, you see, even if you get yourself a jigsaw, you can work with this because they're not as expensive.
Yeah, jigsaws aren't as expensive, but the thing is, it with the jigsaws, right? You're only holding the blade at one point.
As long as you have it firm, it should be okay.
Well, wait. If you want to go for a very fine blade, in order to get in and do very, very fine work. It means that the blade wibbles and wobbles. A scroll saw will hold the blade at two ends.
Keeps it on tension.
And it keeps it taut, and it means that you have less. You still get wibble in the blade if you're not careful, but you get a lot less.
Yeah, I don't know, because something like this, I know I'm going to do like what the guy has done here and actually take a sanding block to it. So you're going to clean those edges.
Actually,
anyway.
I have a tip for you there as well. If you scroll down, he's using the sanding block to keep going.
Give a beveled edge.
To get a beveled edge.
Yeah.
Dremels are your friend.
If you don't mind making a horrible mess.
Well, you know, do it outside.
Yeah.
That's what we always did. Do it outside, wear a mask, okay? So make sure you wear a particulate mask, okay? And goggles. Goggles for all of this kind of stuff, or glasses. And what we did was worked the Dremel. And whatever way you hold the Dremel, make sure you try to hold it so that the Dremel is rotating away from you, so if the biscuit flies out of your hand, it doesn't fly into your.
Also, you're not blasting dust just right up into your face.
So what we did was we had a Dremel. Sometimes you can get a thing to lock a Dremel in place like that, and then you can just run the biscuit around it, and it gives you a beveled edge in seconds, rather than going at it with a sanding block, where you are going to be spending some minutes to get a beveled edge.
Depends on what you prefer to do.
No, really, you're
I would go at it with
minutes.
A sanding block.
Can we go a bit further down his blog to see how far he's got with this? No, so there we go.
Yeah, we've got some of the stuff starting to go on.
Now, that's pine bark. Right. That's a great material. Mm. You can pick that up from gardening stores.
Ah.
Big bags of pine bark. Yeah. And they make beautiful rocky outcrops.
It looks like he's taking a razor saw to split it.
Yep.
Oh, and then... he's just distressing it a little bit with his clippers, which is quite cool.
Yeah.
Really nice effect he's getting.
Oh, what do you see when it's painted? If you keep going down, we'll see if he's got to that stage. Look at that. He didn't even paint it. Oh, yeah, he did paint it. Yeah. He did paint it.
So he got some black.
Yeah, it's one of the things I really liked about this is that it's very simple and easy to do terrain, but it looks really effective once it has been finished.
Yeah.
So it fits in with whatever kind of tabletop you're trying to make as well.
Yeah,
so
just
I like the little extras that he's putting in between the rocks to actually give a bit of life to it. You know, because a lot of people will see they'll do a rock and it's just a rock on a base. But actually having those little bits of flock and stuff coming up through there.
Aren't they lovely?
Yeah, it just adds that little bit of extra life to it.
Okay, next up we have some Trenchworks by Soap Dodger. That was Matty J.I.S. Was the guy that did the rocks. And Pete Bick, again, was the guy that did the industrial walls. We have Soap Dodger, who's doing Trenchworks. So if we bring that up, Ben, what do you think of these?
I really like this. And one of the things that I picked this one out for is the fact that it's got more of a narrative going on with the terrain. And it's one of the things that you always want to see, even with even when it's with smaller pieces, you want to tell a little bit of a story with what's going on there. And I think these really did that because you obviously had all the look of it, the battlefield and stuff like that, the bits that have been discarded and all sorts of things. Mm-hmm. So a really nice piece of terrain, these.
Now there's your other option for that hardboard is actually taking a Stanley knife to it. Now that I wouldn't do just because it takes a lot of work.
Yeah, and there's a good chance that you can actually cut yourself. Believe it or not, power tools, as dangerous as they are
safer than some of the other tools.
In many cases, as long as you're careful, they're a lot safer, I would say, than some of the hand tools, especially things like Stanley knives and stuff like that.
If it's a brand new blade, you can hit yourself with it, take half your thumb off, and you'll not notice.
I know myself and Lloyd have injured ourselves more with blades than we ever have with power tools. And I think with power tools, you tend to have a bit more awareness about you anyway. You will tend to try and be more careful.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you're interested in seeing how the Trenchworks is going, remember, all these links are in the show notes. Finally, we have Crash Terrain by Iron Mammoth. So let's get a look at this one.
Yeah, so this one was something that was a little bit different and a little bit sort of more out there. But again, it fell into this sort of narrative style of things I like to see on the tabletop, especially with terrain. Mm. So this one was potentially something from like a post-apocalyptic setting or a zombie apocalypse or something like that. Mm. And effectively, what he was doing was he was taking some cards, smashing them up, making them into really nice scenery pieces for the tabletop that would be great by the side of the road or off the path in a forest or something like that. And obviously, there's a couple of jokes in there as well for the British as well. So good.
There's one thing he's doing here which I like the idea of. So I'm assuming this is just a little plastic car that he's then taken the lighter to and actually melted it.
Yes.
To actually get that damage on there. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't have thought of doing that, to be honest with you.
Well, actually, the other thing you can do, and we have done this to great effect, is buy reasonably to scale die-cast cars.
Aye.
Okay. Myself and John have done this. We've bought die-cast cars, took them apart, and then went at them with a hammer, and then put the components back in.
Yes.
Or we've just taken them and went at them with a hammer. And there's some really cool stuff you can do. In fact, I think we have a battle report coming up soon with this in effect, where we've got Terminator coming. Aye. We're going to do a how to play on Terminator.
Aye.
And we've used this very technique. This is great, though. The guy hanging out of the car.
Well, if you're doing sort of a zombie apocalypse game, you can imagine there'd be a zombie just hanging out of the car and can't get away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Isn't it really
it's very
good?
Cool.
Yeah. The fact that it's crashed into a street sign is really cool.
Yeah. Right, we have a ton more. Come on over to beastsofwar.com and check them out. Now, we're trying to get involved as well. So as we get time, some of us are trying to get our own little bits and pieces in. But I know John and Lloyd were totally inspired by this.
Yeah.
So they created a hobby lab. This went out recently for backstagers. And this is Orc Terrain, made completely from the leftover bits of Starbucks.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're in Starbucks often, well, even semi-often, don't throw away your stuff. Keep it and then come in because Lloyd and John turned John's bad habit into some really, really nice-looking orc scatter terrain.
Yeah,
and it's a great tutorial. And if you fancy having a look, come on over and join backstage and check it out. Mm. Right. I want to talk a couple of bits and pieces of news before we get into our chat with Dave on all things Dropfleet. So if you bear with us for 2 seconds, we're just going to tell you about some hubs.
Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastsofwar.com. Become a general of mighty armies at the Kings of War Hub. Take command of elves, dwarves, and orcs in this game of masked fantasy combat on beastsofwar.com.
Well, as you know, at the weekend past, it was Gen Con, and our US team was there live blogging all 4 days of Gen Con. So we have this fabulous 4-day live blog on the site. So before we moved on to some other news stories, I just wanted to pull some stuff up just to give you a little bit of a look-see at what you may have missed if you haven't seen it yet. So 4 days. Justin, what have we got?
Tons of stuff. Absolutely tons of stuff. So first up, we've got a funky little board game, which actually looks like it could be a lot of fun for you and me to sit down and do a little dungeon delving.
Yeah.
Or mining delving, I think you would call this one. So it's quite cool. Further down, the hall was just absolutely packed with people left, right, and center. What else have we got here?
We have tons of galleries, tons of interviews with like the halos in there.
Yeah.
We have the dice throwers, everything you could want. Now, if you quickly scan through each of the days, Justin.
Yeah,
right?
Well, I believe this was day one. On day two, they stopped off for some Doctor Who fun.
Yep.
Caught up with some cosplayers. Saloon Tycoon. Now, that one has me a little curious. I want to know exactly what that game is, because you remember the way you had the old Railroad Tycoon games and stuff? I'm wondering if that's something similar to that coming to the tabletop.
Oh, a chain of Wild West bars, I have no doubt.
Yeah.
We've got Talks with Paizo on Pathfinder.
Yeah.
Castle Molds. That's our buddy Bruce Hurst's work there. And this
one,
guy was
one
amazing.
Guy making a gigantic blow up balloon sculpture.
It's worth checking out later in the live blog, because you actually then see it finished.
Nice.
And the dragon is there with its big red wings and everything. So anyway, I just wanted to draw your attention to the fact that if you're interested in what took place at what I considered probably to be the best Gen Con ever.
Yeah.
As far, in my humble opinion, and I've watched a few of them now, this was the best Gen Con I have ever seen. I just thought there was a real energy about it, and the amount of new stuff at it was nothing normal, including the new release, the new war game coming out of Fantasy Flight, which we'll be talking about tomorrow on the XLBS show.
Yeah.
Yes.
In other news, we have the brand new Band of Brothers starter set for Bolt Action 2. So we're getting very close to the Bolt Action 2 launch date now. Ben, what can you tell us about it?
Yeah, sure. So this is going to be the new starter set that's going to be out. It's going to be completely plastic, and this will be coming whenever the new rulebook hits as well. And inside here, you're going to have the US versus the Germans. There's going to be 24 new plastic US airborne, which are very, very cool, Mohawk and all, versus the 12 German Panzer Grenadiers, and they're also going to get a half track. As well as that, you're going to get some fantastic extra bits and pieces in there as well. So you've got the Rune Farm, there's a rulebook, all the quick reference stuff you need to get playing, templates and tokens and all sorts of different things as well. And of course, there is going to be the rulebook itself that's coming out alongside this, which is very cool. And if you pre-order it from Warlords, you're going to get the awesome general pattern miniature as well, which is pretty epic. So yeah, very cool indeed. Lots of good stuff coming out for Bolt Action.
Yeah, now I was talking to the guys from Warlords while they were across about this. For the actual US infantry, they've done a little bit of a redesign on them. So normally people complain a little bit that, you know, the arms are a little hard to get together because it's three pieces, because you have arm, weapon, arm.
Yeah.
This time they've went back to the drawing board a little bit, and they are looking to fix that with this set. So that if that is something that people out there have been worrying about, don't worry, the guys are on it.
Ah, interesting.
One of the other really cool things I thought I mentioned about this is, obviously, as I was saying, that they're bringing out this new US airborne kit that's full of lots of optional extras and things like that. So you've got different ways for them to pose and stuff. The Grenadiers, the Panzer Grenadiers are just as sort of evocative and characterful. So they won't feel like you're getting almost like a bit of a raw deal with these guys, because they're just as cool and interesting to put together, which is always cool. So very cool.
In other new releases, we have the Shadowcast Dragiri for Dark Age. There's some gorgeous looking stuff in this. Check these out.
Yeah, so this was one of the factions, or maybe a sub-faction, I guess you'd say, that was announced at Gen Con. And this is obviously for the Dragiri, as you say. This is the Shadowcast with some very nasty-looking creatures in here. Oh, some of them are absolutely huge as well. Like, a lot of the Dark Age stuff is a bit larger than life anyway, especially with the Dragiri and stuff. But these are that level again, which is pretty fantastic. I mean, the Huntress is just crazy, the sort of strange spider lady.
Yeah, let's go back to the Huntress there, Justin, because
here we go.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Just look at it. It's absolutely fabulous. Does it come with the scenic base and everything? You would imagine it would, so...
I'm not entirely sure whether or not it does come with the scenic base, but if it does, that would be a rather awesome epic extra, I guess, for this one. But
I'm almost certain it does come with the scenic base, and the reason being is the way the legs and stuff are set up, it looks like it was absolutely made for that.
Yeah, it looks designed, because if it was sitting flat, the body might be off at a strange angle.
I would you know, there's a collector's piece just in and of itself, isn't it, really? So,
well, you see, if I remember from the discussions I had with the guys from Cool Mini or Not while they were across here, it's actually the Shadowcaster Geary that are up to all the shenanigans in the background. So these guys are sort of that shadowy undertone faction that are just in the background pulling the strings and making things go horribly, horribly wrong.
Yeah.
It's doing that other thing as well that I think has been really great about all the stuff from Dark Age, and that they're looking at the sculpts themselves and adding that extra dose of character in. So you see a lot more facial animation, well, not animations, but you see facial details and stuff that you wouldn't have seen before on their past sculpts and stuff. So yeah, really nice step up.
Yeah, they are fantastic looking. Although the spiders are really creepy. They have done those really well.
Yeah. I like that miniature in the middle there, actually. You know, it's almost like evil Tau. It does have an evil Tau sorceress kind of look about it. Mm. What a fabulous looking faction.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, next up, I have a lovely miniature for you. This is a Twisted's Monkey King miniature. Mm-hmm. Get a look at this, right? What a beautiful, beautiful sculpt. Mm-hmm. If you're, I'm just looking at it. I showed this to Lloyd, actually, before the show started. And Lloyd was going, oh, God, I want that. It just has that fabulous, almost like a steampunk. I want him for Volsung, you know, never mind Twisted, you know?
Well, you see, the Twisted things, every last one that they've done so far has just been absolutely fantastic.
It's like a little work of art, isn't it?
They've really outdone themselves with this one. I love the actual scroll work they've done up and along his staff there. It's just so detailed. Yeah.
Ben, what can you tell us about him?
Well, he's a fantastic new character that's going to be playing alongside some of the other stuff that you'll see out there. So you'll be able to include him with things like the Guild of Harmony and stuff in the game, which is very, very cool. One of the things that they really wanted to express with this is that they wanted to carry over that Far Eastern theme to him and that sort of adventuring mentality. So you'll see him in sort of like his traveling clothes and things like that, that maybe you'd paint up in sort of a more faded color and stuff, which is very cool. The one other thing that they added to this, which I thought was a really nice characterful add-on, was the way that they've designed his steampunk leg.
Yes.
In most cases, what they've done with it, they've just made it effectively just, you know, a big huge bit of metal, etc., really. But with this one, they added the spring into the top bit of it because they realized that he was going to be a very acrobatic style character. So they've gone with that to try and tell a little bit more of the story, which is really fantastic
in the thing, isn't it, which is great.
Yeah,
it's just a fantastic so well model. Executed brilliant model,
really, really
absolutely
well
beautiful. And then we have a kind of a little bit of an update on Kings of War Historical, Ben.
Yes, so we've talked about this a little bit before on the weekend, and we were sort of hypothesizing what they were going to be doing with this in terms of Mantic and Kings of War and all this kind of thing. But we actually got a release date for this, and it should be coming out towards the end of September. The pre-orders will begin sort of the very end of August. And this is what Mantic are going to be doing in the historical sphere. So they're going to be dealing with a whole bunch of different factions and eras and armies and stuff from all over different periods of history, like we hypothesized.
Yeah.
But the main thing that they wanted to stress is that you don't need to have the other Kings of War rulebook to play this. You can just pick this book up and it'll have all the core rules inside it, but then it'll have all the extra things that they've added on to make sure that you can play historical games.
Nice.
And one of the interesting things as well that I think you'll be very happy with, Justin,
yeah,
or maybe it was Lloyd who was very interested in this, I can't remember exactly, but you can actually play Fantasy Armies versus Historical and put in huge legendary creatures and mythological beasts as well,
I'm
which
happy.
Is very, very cool. So, yeah.
So Lloyd could effectively create his historical Roman army and then fantasize it up a little
Throw in some chimeras.
Or his historical
stuff.
Kind of samurai army
and
then do a few extra kind of dragons. Yeah. This, I think, is kind of like the new, almost like foundation, I think, for our kind of war games, right? Because we talked about this last week on the XLBS show with Konflikt 47, right?
Yeah.
And how one of the great things about Konflikt 47 is you were able to take your bolt action army and then kind of pulp it up, you know, take it, weird it up with some additional add-on pieces. The ability to do that to the historical armies, so you could have an army of crusaders or something like that, and then stick dragons in it, you know, it's like you really start to almost get into that Game of Thrones kind of thing where you chuck a giant in or something like that, and it just gives you the opportunity to play with some awesome stuff.
An Egyptian army with some sphinxes and stuff running around would be quite cool.
Oh, I love it.
Absolutely. Cool idea.
Love it. We will definitely keep you posted on that as we hear more. Okay, we're going to take a quick break to tell you about some hubs. After the hubs, John and Justin are going to be with Dave, and he's going to take us through the game of Dropfleet and the painted miniatures. So enjoy. We'll be back shortly.
Flames of War brings you the battles of World War II in epic 15mm scale. Go to the hub on beastofwar.com to find news, tactics, and tutorials about the game. Keep your blaster handy. The West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastofwar.com.
Hello, everybody. It is the moment you have been waiting for, and myself and John have been waiting for. We're sat down with Dave from Hawk Wargames, and as you can see, Dropfleet Commander is getting closer and closer to this game landing. Dave, come on.
At last. What?
Yeah. Can we get an update on progress of Dropfleet Commander?
Okay, so production for the Kickstarter is going well, pretty much on plan, on schedule. Mm-hmm. Nothing's gone wrong.
Knock on wood, yeah.
Again, you know, we're doing pretty much everything in the UK, so most of it are people we've worked with before, so stuff is progressing as we expected it to. Mm-hmm. The sprues, which we'll show you later on, are beautiful, and I'm really happy with them.
Well, you'll probably have myself and John sitting here just going, oh my God, he's beautiful. Yeah. Can I keep this?
No, they're really, really nice. We've taken delivery of a lot of the elements for the Kickstarter, not all of them yet. We're still waiting on a few things.
Yeah.
And then we've got to pack 4,000 orders.
Yeah, is it something like 100 Admiral orders?
Those are the big ones, you know. And then you've got some of the numbers are insane. I had a really, really funny one actually that's worth just chucking in just for. I got a call in the office and they said, Dave, you better take this. So I was like, okay, right. What have you got? We've got a delivery for you. All right, where are you? They were at my parents' house instead of the warehouse in Birmingham, in my parents' house in London. What have you got? We've got a pallet. All right. How much does a pallet weigh? 365 kilos.
Lovely.
Nearly half a ton. Half a ton pallet at my parents' house. What is it? Oh, it's from the... It's dice. It's 150,000 dice on a pallet.
which is
one of the funniest moments in the whole thing, and just wonderful.
Well, I'm sure I can just imagine your mom and dad standing there mildly confused going, Dave, what did you order?
Yeah, fortunately, they weren't in. Which is, you know, because my parents are pretty earnest and they'd probably have just taken the delivery and then...
and then you would have had to shift.
So it was panic over, but it was funny. It made me laugh for a long time, and you've got to have some stuff to make you laugh.
Yeah. Well, on the table in front of us, we have something that very, very few people have seen.
Mm-hmm.
And if I may, I would like to show these off because I have been waiting to catch sight of these since the Kickstarter ended. What we have here are, these are the battlecruisers?
These are the battleships.
Oh, the battleships.
Yeah. These are the toys with the big guns.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the Scourge and going, oh my God, I need like two of these on the tabletop, like right now.
Yeah, aren't so these...
They are beautiful.
These have been an awful lot of work for me. They're the most involved sculpts I've ever done so far, like in terms of hours, complexity, everything, like challenging to sculpt, all of them were. These actually weren't on the Kickstarter. We showed off one of them.
The Beijing.
Mm-hmm. But the rest of them, no one's seen before.
Mm.
They saw a sample of the Shaltari one at Salute.
Yeah.
But not painted. And the PHR one, Scourge, no one have seen them yet. Mm. So they're brand new. We wanted to show backers and people who didn't back Kickstarter as well what's coming. Yeah. You know, after all the things, all the shinies that we've already shown off over time.
No. It's basically the game's going to land, people are going to start to play the games, and then they have these beautiful meaty pieces to add to their fleets.
Yeah, these are the granddaddies.
Yeah,
the
right. Well, I tell you what, let's go through them. So take the Scourge one first, because I'm playing Scourge. That's the one I want to see.
All right,
of course.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's have a look at it. Slide it across there.
This is the Demon Scourge battleship. Now, the one cool thing about the Scourge battleships is that they're completely poseable.
Yeah, I'm seeing all this segmentation going along here.
So this is unusual for a spaceship. Obviously, you don't normally get this level of poseability.
Mm-hmm.
So all these individual segments, you know, I would point to them, they all move.
Yeah.
The head moves. All these fins, there are two layers of fins. You can actually show the underside on here. You can see all the detail
that's under that.
There's a lot of more detail underneath than there is on top, which is I always spend time. We'll show the engines actually. There's the engines are also on the fins, so there's banks of the things. You know,
that is gorgeous.
I'm really happy with the way these have turned out.
Mm.
These I actually assembled these today. Mm-hmm. These are the first fully assembled battleships I've ever seen. So this is one of the most rewarding parts of what I do, is actually seeing finished models done. So yeah, I'm really happy to see this.
You get to start seeing them on your computer screen in your renders, and then you get to finally check them.
Okay, the first thing I have to wonder, it's big, it's beautiful. What does it do in game? Just really quickly, just something about it for everybody.
So the demon is guns, mm-hmm. effectively. So it's your standard battleship for the Scourge. Mm-hmm. Lots and lots of standard munitions. Mm-hmm. It's got a twin burn through at the front as well. So it's just armed to the teeth, and like all battleships, it soaks up an enormous amount of damage. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a bullet magnet. They all are.
Yeah, you know. Which is kind of why I want to see two of them on the table, just slowly rolling up the field with John on the other side going, why is it not dying? Why is it not dying?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, as a Scourge battleship, it's the fastest battleship in the game, mm-hmm. And it's the most aggressive. Nice. Oh, it's one of the most aggressive, because the other one's equally as scary in the same way.
Let's have a look at our other Scourge one here.
Yeah. So if we bring the other one in, we can probably see them both. The posing is very different on these two.
Yep.
I just set them up differently. We can get rid of this one and just have that one.
So this one's a little bit more predatory, but it's a little bit lower and leaner.
This is the Dragon class. Mm-hmm. This one is a bit more specialist. It's a carrier, for one. That's these structures at the front here.
So we can launch fighters from this?
So that launches fighters and bombers.
Lovely.
Here's a couple of them for scale. These are actually double scale. All the minis for the launch assets are double scale, because they'd just be specs otherwise.
Yeah.
But you know, you can see them. But also underneath here,
we're rescuing the mini and flipping again.
Oh, that's all right.
Seeing two pods.
You can see those. That's where some of the fighters and bombers are, in those kind of big biological lumps underneath there.
Yeah, yeah.
But also these two structures there, that bit, and there's one on the other side. Uh-huh. They hold Scourge torpedoes.
Ah.
So Scourge torpedoes work a little differently from the other faction's torpedoes, and they're all called Corruptor.
Okay.
What that does is, the way Scourge torpedo works, is it punches, it hits, it does damage like everyone else's, mm-hmm. bit less damage, but once it's done damage, it injects thousands of razor worms inside the enemy ship, and they wreak havoc. They're in there, they are not going to go away.
Yeah. Like the razor worms, are they just going after the crew, or are they going after all tech?
Yeah, the crew systems, they're going to be biting through power lines, they're going to be doing all sorts of carnage aboard, and basically what happens is your ship slowly dies once it's been corrupted, mm-hmm. and there's no way of stopping it. It's just going to keep on rolling until you die.
Right, John, guess what? I'm putting a few of onto the table at the very least. I want at least a couple of Corruptor launchers. Can I get these on the cruisers as well?
No, you can't. Oh. Torpedoes are rarity in Dropfleet. Only a few ships can have them. In fact, only battleships have torpedoes, except for one of the PHR heavy cruisers.
Mm. I see. Okay, well.
Yeah, so they're a real special thing, torps.
And they sound as if they do a lot of work for
you. They are. Scary as hell.
Yeah, all right, let's move on to John's faction, because he's going to be playing the UCM.
UCM, yep, of course.
So I believe that's your Beijing, yeah?
Yep, so this is the Beijing. A lot of the viewers will have seen this one already.
Yeah.
This is no surprise to anyone. This is your standard UCM gun battleship. Mm-hmm. So you've got mass driver turrets at the back here, you've got three more at the front, mm-hmm. and you've got a burn through laser on the prow as well. So standard gun-armed battleship. Really lovely model, and you know, this has got the second most features of any part I've ever designed ever, behind the Shaltari one, which we'll get to in a minute.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like the Beijing, that's the one you've also done a two-up of, yeah?
Yeah, yeah, that's a two-up on the Kickstarter, because we wanted to get the battleship on the Kickstarter in some way to show it off and to show people what a battleship was going to look like. Mm-hmm. That's a beast, the two-up Beijing is beautiful.
Well, I'm guessing it's like twice the size of what we're seeing.
Yeah, yeah, and then if you multiply the length by two, then obviously the bulk and everything just goes right up, so it's a lovely chunk of resin.
Beautiful.
That one.
So I've got one of those coming in my Kickstarter, as well as that one.
yeah,
you have the scaled version and the two.
Yeah.
So... this is the other UCM battleship that no one's seen before. Mm. This is the New York class.
Okay, so I'm seeing mass drivers, I'm seeing a missile launcher at the front. And what's the other thing down on the bottom there?
Yeah, so this is launch bays for fighters and bombers. Mm-hmm. Again, I bring a couple in. And there are the little things.
Okay.
This one, it has a torpedo bay at the front. Unlike the Scourge one, it has two profiles, so it has launch one, Mm-hmm. What that means is you can choose to fire them both at the same time, or you can fire one and then wait till next turn and fire the other.
All right, so they're separate weapon systems, independent of each other.
The UCM one is a single profile launch two. Mm. Well, launch one, but L2, which means you can only fire one per turn, but you can fire two over the course of the game. Yeah. So it's marginally worse than being able to launch them both at once.
Well, if you have one really meaty target that you want to die quickly, yeah.
Yeah, it'd be nice to, you know, you should fire them both, but this one has one tube and a second torpedo inside the ship, so once you fire one, the second one's got to be moved into the tube before it can be fired.
Yeah, you just
and actually a torpedo will use the close-up. This torpedo is actually, unlike the fighters and the bombers, is in scale, because the torpedoes are massive. I mean, this is a battleship, you know, so this is one of the biggest ships in the game, and a torpedo is not insignificant. No, when that hits, that does a tremendous amount of damage.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, if you look at the size of some of the actual two upsized fighters and bombers, imagine them at the proper 1-to-1 scale. This is a big, massive nuclear rocket of death.
Yeah, yeah. Your torpedo is devastating. It overcomes all countermeasures because it's got like meters of solid armor. Mm. So all these point defense lasers on the back, they don't do anything against torpedoes.
Just scratching the paint.
Yeah, the point defense gets rid of missiles, which there are a lot of. So if you kind of like the imagery of torpedoes, that's close action weapons mostly. There are tons of those. All the ships have close action weapons. Mm-hmm. Torps are a special thing by themselves. So yeah, New York, a little bit more expensive in points than the Beijing, a bit more specialist. Launch is powerful anyway. Mm-hmm. Fighters and bombers are very flexible. You can do a lot with them, but lacking firepower.
All right. Well, John, which of the two do you think you're going to field on the tabletop
I'm
first?
I'm going to field both of them if I can. But I'm obviously I have a Beijing coming anyway in my pledge, so like the Beijing will be the first one I'll roll out.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you won't have one by then.
Well, you won't have a 1-to-1. I have the 2-up.
Yeah. Mm. Aha.
Yeah, yeah. You could use the 2-up. I mean, it's a bit unwieldy.
Well, it would kind of feel like you're going giant hunting at that stage.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you get a battle cruiser, you're probably thinking of the Atlantis class.
Yeah. Yes, and I've got the Scourge one coming as well.
That's right.
Yeah, Basilisk. Yeah.
Exactly.
There's also
so
the Avalon.
We are going to be reasonably evenly matched to start off with, John. It's after we get it in our hands and start adding stuff like this, we're really going to tailor our forces and really see the tactics coming out, which I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, you're going to need bigger games for battleships. I mean, you could field one in a small game, but it's going to be a real kind of, whoa. If it dies, then the whole game changes. You know, really, it's for 1,500 points, kind of standard tournament level.
Yeah.
You can take two, that's an option. Taking two is quite weighty towards big ships, but the cool thing about a big ship is that until it's dead, it's kicking out.
A lot of punishment.
Yeah, yeah, so you've really got to focus on it, and it really changes the dynamic depending on which battleship you're facing, you know.
Okay, right, tell you what, move that one out the way.
All right.
Right, John, Sheltari or PHR? Your choice.
I don't know, because we both like these models, and I don't know which one you want to show first.
Let's do Sheltari first.
Go for it.
Okay. So this paint job, I've got to say, I didn't do it, so I can say this, is stunning paint job.
It's beautiful,
like,
isn't it?
It's a beautiful model, this. Like, the level of detail on it. This is the one that's the most complex model I've ever done.
Yeah.
This took me, ages. I think it was about 9 days of solid CAD to get this ship done. I mean, it is encrusted with detail. It's also the longest ship. Mm-hmm. Actually, one thing we've not been doing, I bought props is other ships for scale.
Yeah.
So here's a frigate. Okay. Sheltari frigates are actually quite big. They're the biggest frigates in the game physically. And then you've got a cruiser. It's actually a heavy cruiser. Mm-hmm. Obsidian class.
Yeah.
Just if we get it in there. There it is. So that's how much bigger the battleships are than the cruisers.
Now, for the Sheltari, we do know that as a faction, their ships are a lot more sneaky, a little more fragile, and a lot more hang at the back and blast the hell out of somebody from the other side of the table. What's the battleship going to be doing?
Well, this battleship, the Diamond class, has three enormous particle lancers. That's its primary weapon. That's not a turret, by the way. That's fixed.
Yeah.
Right.
They're just too big to be on a turret. I mean, that's going to weigh who knows how much.
Hundreds of thousands of tons.
Yeah, so these weapons, particle lances, are a speciality of the Sheltari.
Yeah.
Particle lances basically automatically bypass armor. Mm. They lack ultimate damage capability. So if you're good with your dice with other weapons, they'll do more damage than these will. Mm. But these will reliably dish out.
I don't know. Given the choice, taking consistent damage over random massive damage, I'm going to go with that consistent damage.
Yeah, yeah, consistent damage. Consistent damage is nice, and I say not much damage. It does a lot of damage because it's a battleship's primary, yeah. So it's going to sting like hell. Mm-hmm. It also has some disintegrators at the front as well, which is standard.
Where are they?
Those are these things here.
Ah, those structures.
That's
in the front, right.
Standard Shaltari guns. Effectively, yeah. that's how they work. Mm-hmm. They've got arcs. You know, obviously you're tied to front narrow mm-hmm. with that massive weapon on the. So you've got to be a bit careful. About facing with this ship.
Yeah, but having the standard weapons out to the sides means that if there's something that has got past your arc of fire, you can still do something to it. You're not just going, ah, crap, I've missed my angle.
Yeah, yeah, because your battleships, you know, steering is an issue with a ship this big, and you've, mm-hmm. you know, it's powerful, it's long-ranged, because it's Shaltari, so they've got the best scan ranges in the game, so you can stand off. This weapon does have bloom, though. Special rule that means it's just so loud. Mm. When you fire this, it's going to add spikes.
Everybody knows.
It's going to add spikes just by firing this weapon because it's so enormous. So that's a factor that you've got to bear in mind. Mm-hmm. So it's a bit more brazen.
Yeah, so it's basically be cagey with it and use it as a sniper.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's got the range and it's going to be fantastic at killing off specific, like, I want that ship dead, yeah, reliably sure. dead early on. Then this ship is great for that. And it will soak up a lot of damage. With shields up, it's going to be tough. Kill this ship off.
Awesome.
Yeah. So the other Shaltari one, I've got to swap a part out for that.
That's absolutely.
And this
fine.
Is actually, you know what? If we leave that on there, put the camera on, and I'll do a bit of a reveal, which is always cool. Yeah,
okay. So here we are.
So this is your. You actually, when you get this, these are all resin kits worth mentioning. Okay. Battleships. Mm-hmm. And you get both variants in the blister.
Okay.
So you can build either, and you get swappable parts. Mm-hmm. So this one here, if I take this turret off, ooh. You can see inside the flight deck. And in there,
oh, wow.
there are all the lovely fighters and bombers ranged up on their lifts mm-hmm. and everything. Mm-hmm. So if I put the top section on, this is the Platinum Class Supercarrier, which is the only supercarrier in the game at the moment. Supercarrier being a really big ship with pretty much only fighters and bombers launch capacity.
Yeah.
It's got the little disintegrators at the front, which is, you know, okay, but
So basically this is the full-on aircraft carrier now.
Yeah, yeah, this is at the moment, it has launch 9, which means 9 bases of fighters or bombers, which is awfully powerful. Yeah. It might be dropping slightly, but you're paying, this is the most expensive battleship in the game, mm-hmm. points, and it's very powerful. It sits at the back, but it doesn't have any firepower being launch, it means it goes last in the mm-hmm. turn. So the enemy has plenty of opportunities to try and kill it before it can launch.
So I'm guessing you really need to escort this particular ship.
You do, you need to protect it a bit. Shaltari will probably be launching more fighters than any of the other factions, because one, Shaltari fighters are amazing. Mm-hmm. Two, when the shields are up on Shaltari ships, you lose your point defense.
Right.
And fighters can provide point defense.
Yeah.
So this has a slightly different dynamic from the other factions' battleships, where you might think, well, I don't need more point defense on this ship. I've got point defense 9, whatever, that's fine, I'm happy with that.
Yeah.
But Shaltari, especially late game, when you tend to be stuck in, shields up, close action weapons start to kick in because ships are close, that's where you need point defense. Mm-hmm. So you might start, you know, instead of using bombers, you might want to use fighters. Mm-hmm. So it's a powerful ship.
Yeah.
You know, that you pay your money and you take your choice either way. But you get both in the blister, you know, you can magnetize
it. I do like
that
idea. Yeah. Because whenever I'm looking at the Scourge one here, I'm seeing the points where it's different, and I'm thinking, you know what, I could magnetize that quite easily.
Yeah, I mean, some of them are less magnetizable than others, mm-hmm. but generally you can. They're not specifically designed to be magnetized, but you won't have any real problems with it.
That's just, you know, part of the hobby mostly. Is actually, you know, can I do it?
Yeah.
You know, having a go at it.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of designed for you to build one or the other, but mm-hmm. certain ones, especially the Shaltari ones, really easy, because it's just that top bit that mm-hmm. swaps over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Cool. Right, next up.
This now, is the biggest one.
Yes, this
is one of the most beautiful models I've ever seen in a long time.
Is this such a sleek look to it?
Yeah, you know? See it from the side. This is the Heracles battleship. Mm. This is physically the largest battleship in the game. Mm. It has the most hull points. Like most PHR ships, it's got a ton of hull points. Here's a frigate for scale.
Yeah. And, see, it's actually funny because I was looking at the frigates and the cruisers whenever they first came out, and I thought, wow, those are really, really nicely sized ships. I'm now seeing the battleships, and it's just
there's a cruiser.
Okay, the cruisers were nice. The battleships are gorgeous.
Yeah, yeah. It's I'm really happy with this. Again, I assembled this model today, so this is the first time I've seen one built, because I do all the cleanup of all the parts and then I send them off in bits to get painted, to get underneath there to see all the engines. That's
yeah,
beautiful engine bank back there. Ton of work went into this ship, a lot of work, all of them actually. But, you know, they had to be done for the book, because obviously you've got to have images of the battleships for the book.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was part of the work for the Kickstarter, even though they weren't on the Kickstarter. It's still part of the deliverables for me.
Basically, you want to be able to show that beautiful piece off.
Yeah, yeah. And this is it's a monster ship.
It's like a Cadillac. It just has the lines, it has everything, you know.
It was a big design decision with the PHR to leave those hull areas completely smooth and devoid of any panel lines or anything. That was a kind of a big call for me to make. Mm. But, you know, they are sort of, this one at least is about 1 kilometer long, I think, or a little less. So it's a big ship.
Right, so we won't see you building a 10 mil scale of this.
No. It'd probably be bigger than the room we're sat in right now, actually.
Yeah,
no, it'd be a lot bigger. Yeah, because the New Orleans class is only like a third of the length. So this would be about 9 meters long in 10 mil scale.
Basically, you're going to be taking up maybe a quarter of the hall for Salute next year.
It would be big. Like yeah, so no, I won't be building a 10 mil scale one of these. Weapon-wise, you've got two battleships. This is Heracles. Mm-hmm. So you've got heavy mass drivers down all the way down there.
Yeah, so that's the broadside aspect that we've seen.
Yeah,
with
so
PHR.
All PHR ships are broadsidey. Mm-hmm. Well, not all of them, but most of them are. That's their big thing.
Yeah,
broadsides are efficient for packing in more guns in a given space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so that's good if you're outnumbered and if you can position yourself well.
Yeah,
because generally a PHR ship has almost double the firepower of any equivalent, but you're limited in arcs, so it's actually, in playtesting, we found it's very difficult to unleash both. But if you can, happy days for you.
Right, so I can fire both broadsides.
Yeah, yeah.
You do the Pirates of the Caribbean thing, you get in between two ships and you go, weapons free!
Yeah, and weapons free and just unleash.
Yep.
These, the other thing is a PHR rules thing, their mass drivers are split in calibre.
Mm-hmm.
So the other factions, the lock value changes. The lock value changes with these two, but they have extra rules, so you've got light calibre, which is loads of little tiny guns, and that's designed specifically to hit frigates. So you get bonuses if you're firing against small ships. Medium, which is just average, good against everyone. Heavies, which is these, which you get bonuses for firing at big ships.
Right.
So this is a battleship killer.
Yeah.
This is a battlecruiser killer. It's designed to hit the biggest ships the opponent has.
For Dropfleet Commander, this would be your Man of War.
This is a sledgehammer, this thing. And talking about sledgehammers, on the front, it looks pretty small here. That's just the muzzle. That's the dark matter cannon. Yeah, the dark matter cannon runs all the way through here. This part is actually, there's a gap between these two sections on the model.
Yep.
You can't see it from this angle, but it's actually a full gap, like a jawline almost.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see inside and see the detail of this big weapon running all the way down.
Mm.
This is a crippling weapon. Crippling weapons are very, very rare. There's only one or two of them in the game.
Yeah.
That always does crippling damage when it does damage, which is awful, especially for getting hit if you're another battleship.
Yeah.
Because normally you've got to do half the hull points before you get to roll on the crippling table.
Yeah.
This thing does that every time it hits.
Oh.
So you know about it. So it's going to be causing things like engine failures. It's going to be blowing hull weapon systems off. Mm-hmm. It's going to be doing really nasty things, and it's potent.
Okay.
You know? So yeah, this is the gun one.
Mm-hmm.
I'll now very quickly swap the parts over for the other one.
Okay.
Which is, these are just blue tacked on at the moment because these are done for photography rather than practicality. You know, because it
saves
painting.
All right, so the entire front comes off.
Yeah. So actually, you can see in there the detail. Actually, I'll show you the cannon from the other one. So,
isn't that gorgeous?
Yeah. So there's your cannon.
That is so cool.
There's a ton of detail in there.
Yep.
And underneath the jaw as well. You know, that's fully detailed as well. You can see that. So there you go.
You never skimp on detail, Dave. Like, this is...
No, I mean, my view's always been, if you've got space, like, why be lazy?
Yeah.
You know, once you've done it, and then it's there on all the models, and then everyone can sort of benefit from it once you've gone to the effort.
Yeah. So what is this one, though?
So this is the Minos. This one is a bit more get stuck in in style. So under there, you've got two torpedoes.
Lovely.
These actually are separate parts. So if you want to magnetize them, and then when you fire them, you can take them off the model. Because PHR torpedoes are stored externally, so they actually, you see the things on the model, which is kind of nice.
The entire torpedo pod launches?
Yeah, yeah. So it's just these two big clamps and just boom, off it goes.
Nice.
You know, fluff-wise, that's the PHR decision to protect the ship. Should
stop
the torpedo,
them blowing up.
Yeah, if it blows up on the outside, not on the inside, which is quite a sensible idea, really. So you've got two of those, like the Scourge one, they're two profiles, launch one, so you can fire them both in one go, which is cool.
Yeah.
Also, you've got neutron missiles at the front, which are these, bays, which is a close-action weapon, and that's also crippling.
Yeah.
Lovely.
So both PHR battleships have crippling weapons on the prow. This one, of course, needs to be close. You need to be within scan range before you can use it. So this is a lot more aggressive than the Heracles. Mm-hmm. You've got to mean it with the ship, but oh dear.
Yeah, when you feel it, I'm guessing.
Yeah, yeah, you do. It's more or less the same level of damage potential, maybe slightly lower than the Dark Matter Cannon. Key difference is enemy point defense works against this, and you only get to do the crippling damage if you've actually damaged the other ship. So this is not so good against battleships, because battleships have got tons of point defense. So with your few powerful dice, you're probably not going to get past.
So it's basically more of a close support against cruisers
coming in. Yeah. Cruisers largely,
You can imagine this thing just sweeping across the battlefield against a line of cruisers and just blasting away for a couple of turns.
Yeah, I mean, use those torpedoes on battleships, by all means, because torpedoes are great against battleships.
No. Use that on a cruiser, because why use a flash water when you can use a nuke?
Yeah, I mean, it's a torpedo, one torpedo hit has got a possibility of basically destroying a cruiser outright. It can happen. Not very likely, but it's possible.
Mm. Powerful. Yeah, even if it doesn't destroy it outright, you're bound to do
Yeah, you're going to, you know, that cruiser is not long for this world after being hit by a torpedo.
I'm looking at John's landing craft and thinking, if I had one of those, I'd be targeting one then the other and just try and knock those landing craft out, because yes, it's fun to fly around in space and blow each other up, but this is a game about orbital insertion and actual tactical ground combat as well.
Yeah. I mean, all these battleships. Actually, one thing I didn't mention about the Shaltari ones, specifically, both of them have a small mothership capability as well. So they hold some ground troops. So as part of the whole Shaltari teleport system, you can deploy a few extra tokens if you've got a Shaltari battleship around, which is a cool thing unique to them.
I'm assuming these guys have to stay in high and low atmosphere, otherwise they're going to burn?
Yeah, like everything except for a certain frigates. If you go into atmosphere, you die.
Yeah.
And that's a real problem for battleships, because you could get crippled on half your hull, which you're still very much alive at that point. You get an engine failure, and you're in low orbit, and you fail to repair it, then down you go.
Yeah.
So you've got to be a bit careful. Actually, another thing that I've not mentioned is there's a third UCM battleship.
Right.
Which is the Tokyo class, and you get all three in the blister.
Yep.
Tokyo class is basically a Beijing, but you lose those three big mass driver turrets at the front, and you gain three orbital bombardment turrets. It's the only battleship that's designed for orbital bombardment, which is very UCM, because they're on the offensive and they need to blow stuff up on the ground.
Yeah, scourge targets here, and here, hit them.
Yeah. So that is great, very potent in a battleship form, because it's going to be so hard to kill. It's cheapest points-wise of all the UCM battleships, but you've got to be in low orbit to use.
Also, there's a big risk in
So you've got to be a bit careful.
I don't know, early game, that's going to be a big advantage, because you have to take the battleship to that half health before you start doing that crippling on it.
Yep, but it does still have the burn through on the front, and it still has those four medium turrets at the back, so it's hardly unarmed. It's still pretty potent as far as firepower goes, but then when you get there, you can start OBing stuff, and it's obviously the most powerful OB ship in the game at the moment. So that's worth considering too. That's an alternative choice. It's an interesting one, but we threw that one in quite late in development.
I don't know, because I think that's a good idea, because it means that early game, John can ignore the fact that some of my landing craft are getting down and actually taking locations, and he can just say, you know what, that's fine, I'll deal with you in a little bit.
Yeah, I'll just bomb you out later on.
Or would you use the OB as a late game?
We see that's what I'm thinking. You're not worried early game about stuff happening like that. You're not constantly chasing me to stop me getting to the ground. You can still do it a little bit.
Yeah.
But it puts the emphasis elsewhere that you can actually pick apart other parts of my fleet to begin with.
So I take it then, with looking at the UCM battleships, then the Beijing is basically the aggressor.
Yeah.
And then you have the New York, which is more of a support sort of battleship, and then you have
which is a specialist OB yeah. one. Yeah.
I love the idea. I love the look of these. Yeah. Right. I'll tell you what, guys, we'll take a quick break here, and when we come back, we have some other stuff to show off.
From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastofwar.com. It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastofwar.com.
Hi guys, we're back for more Dropfleet with Dave, and this time we're having a look at some of the PHR. Now, this is the faction that was sort of on the back end of the Kickstarter. It came out, and there's been more and more coming for it. So I know you're quickly wanting to run through what all has came along for this fleet.
Yeah. Okay. So these were they were the last ones I designed as I designed all the ships. And for Kickstarter, we didn't have painted miniatures for the whole faction to show off. We had some, but not everything. Mm. And it's nice to show people these now that they're all done. I thought I'd bring them with me for this segment because it's always worth doing that.
Well, John, what do you think of this fleet once you actually see it just all sitting down and on the tabletop?
It looks absolutely gorgeous. It feels so graceful in a way, but yet I'm trying to remind myself that these ships are meant to be ginormous at the same time.
Yeah. So I think there might be a bit of an argument whenever our Kickstarter comes in because you're going to win the PHR then.
Well, possibly, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're the biggest physically. Mm. They're all a little bit chunkier than everybody. Yeah. Or the other. They've got more hull points. PHR cost a few more points too, but that's just what they are.
Yeah. You know? All right, well, if we actually start running through the fleet. So what is this that we're seeing?
This is an Icarus Vanguard carrier. The Vanguard carrier meaning it's an attack carrier, so it's probably not going to be sat at the back because it's got guns. It's got at the front there, it's got some light mass drivers which are good at killing frigates, and fighters and bombers are good at killing frigates too by default because frigates have low point defense.
Okay,
so they're, you know, that's the best use of fighters and bombers is to hit smaller ships that are more vulnerable.
Right, do we have a miniature of it sitting here?
Of these ones, we don't. Have a miniature of that. I've got a mixed bag, so some of them are photos, some of them are miniatures.
Okay.
On these models, I can move the weapons because they're not. I haven't glued them on for photography purposes. So I've just configured them as I have. So you know, we'll go.
All right. Well, the next one you have an image for, we'll quickly cycle through these. What is this?
This is the Hector, which is a heavy cruiser. Do we have a Hector here? No, we don't.
No, we don't have a Hector, unfortunately.
So it's good that we got a picture.
So Hector, what exactly is this armed with?
So it's got medium mass drivers, which are averagely effective against every ship, really, and a twin burn through at the front.
Ooh,
it's pretty slow because it's a heavy cruiser, but it's tougher than the standard cruisers.
Mm. Well, it's the thing with the PHR. They have that broadside tactic, which just seems absolutely nuts. If you can just, what was it you said, John? Do the Pirates of the Caribbean attack?
Between a couple of ships.
Yeah, if you can get between a couple of ships. You know, unlike most PHR ships, the heavy cruisers have got decent forward-facing firepower, which is a thing with PHR heavies specifically, because generally you're not going to get to shoot much until you get close, where you can start using your broadsides.
All right. Well, next in the lineup,
this is the Bellerophon heavy carrier, the only heavy carrier in the game at the moment. The heavy cruiser chassis with launch capacity. Mm. This one, unlike the Icarus, has two sets of bays. So it's got twice the launch capacity of the Icarus. Yep. This is going to be sitting back. We do have one of those here.
Yep, there we are.
Yep.
So, slide it into view there, please.
So here is the Bellerophon. I love this. I love this ship.
It's just beautiful.
There's a lot of void at the front with the prow. You can see there's lots of gaps where that twin burn through is mounted.
Yeah.
It's a nice thing that's easier to do in plastic.
Mm. Well, John, how would you settle down to paint one of these? Because it looks gorgeous. How would you go at this? Hands up going, not a clue.
No, no. I need to try.
Well,
it's almost like two separate painting techniques for PHR, because you've got these really smooth panel lines contrasted with the really detailed. The mechanical stuff obviously loves washes, inks. Yep. That kind of thing, dry brushing perhaps. The smooth hull sections.
It wants layers, it wants nice airbrush work.
A little bit of airbrush work, freehand if you're into freehand. Deck owls, lots of surface for deck owls if you want to use those.
Mm-hmm.
They're actually the most flexible when it comes to being creative with painting, I think, because of all this canvas that the ships give you, which is cool.
It's going to be very interesting to see what some of the high-end painters out there do with these.
I'm looking forward to it, actually, because I try not to be too, like, this is the paint scheme. You know, I like people to go off and, it's a big universe.
Whatever you want.
Exactly.
Well, I remember the very first Drop Zone Commander book. At the very back of it, you had a submissions page where people had just sent in all their cool and crazy schemes, and it was gorgeous.
Yeah. Oh, we're going to have one of those in the next Dropfleet book for sure. Nice. We'll see what people have come up with, you know.
Nice. Okay, next in the lineup for images, what is this?
So this is the Orion, actually. Mm-hmm. I put the Orion in. Just as a reference, this is their standard cruiser, like your most common standard cruiser. Gun at the front rather than the bone through, which we showed on Kickstarter. This is a turreted weapon, so you've got a bit of flexibility, nice.
It looks quite similar to this one. What's the difference we're seeing between these two?
So the Icarus has light mass drivers and launch capacity and the little turret. This one has medium mass drivers across the board and the little turret, which is medium mass drivers. So it's about as general purpose as you're going to get in the PHR
fleet. This is going to be the backbone of your fleet then?
Yeah. I mean, you can take any cruiser as the backbone of your fleet, but this one is the standard average reliable choice.
The benchmark.
This one here? Yep, that's this one here. That's
Let's have a look at it.
There's your Orion.
It's still quite a sizable thing for being a very general purpose sort of cruiser.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same size as any of the other cruisers. I mean, it's not really any cheaper, because medium mass drivers are not to be sneezed at, because they can hurt anything. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a good all purpose choice. Mm. Like, you know, you don't want your bog standard ships to be not taken, because they've got a purpose in game. Yeah. They're good solid things to build a fleet round. Mm. But that's personal choice. You know, there's a lot of different classes to choose from, especially with PHR. They've got more ships than any other faction.
Yeah, well, next up, what do we have here?
Ooh, so hello. This one is the Orpheus Assault Troop Ship. Mm. This is a type of ship unique to the PHR. All the other factions are actually not the Shaltari. The Scourge and the UCM have troop ships. Mm. Troop ships deploy bulk landers, and a bulk lander is basically a big meat crate to hold loads and loads of infantry.
It's pretty crude.
Yep. So,
you say crude and PHR in the same sentence. I don't really imagine.
I mean, not crude. It's not crude, but it's unsubtle. So, like in the background and in Dropfleet, actually in games, strike carriers, smaller frigate-sized ships, they go into atmosphere and they just deploy dropships.
Yeah.
Dropships carry armor. Mm. Armor is good for killing enemy ground assets. Mm. That's what it does. And also, dropships are small, so they can get round things like orbital defences.
Yeah.
So they're good for attacking a defended target or something you want to be at. You know, the enemy are coming, drop some armour.
Yeah.
You know, bulk landers drop loads of infantry tokens.
Right.
And infantry, bulk landers are big, fat, slow things, so they're easily killed by defence batteries, so they're not very good against defended positions. Right. But once you're down, infantry go inside buildings, and they're really hard to root out with orbital bombardment. Mm. So they have a different place. And also, they launch from cruisers, which launch from low orbit rather than atmo. So they're a different kind of deployment mechanism.
Cool. Okay, what other ones do we have sitting about here? Because we have more on the tabletop, which we actually haven't talked about.
We do.
So pick one of them out here.
Actually, I should briefly mention assault troop ship.
Oh, okay.
I was going to cover that. PHR ones are heavy cruiser based, not cruiser based, unlike the other factions, and they've actually got decent guns. Mm. That's the big difference. So they have the same firepower as a standard cruiser and bulk landers. They cost more points, but the PHR don't have the numbers, but they do have the quality. Mm. PHR are also always like that. Mm. So other ships we've got here, we've got the Theseus light cruiser. The light cruiser has two different, it has medium and light mass drivers.
Mm-hmm.
These are linked batteries, which is cool. So it means you can fire two different weapon systems on standard orders.
Right.
So you can still use the whole broadside, even though they're two different weapons, which is cool. But not as ultimately powerful, and you've got to kind of pick your targets, because one is good against one thing, one's good against others.
I don't know, it feels a little bit more middle of the road, so you are going to be grabbing some of the bonuses for
it's useful for kind of side jobs, and it's got no prowl weapon, but it is cheaper and a bit faster. Mm. So, you know, light cruisers are usually like that, and you have to take two minimum in a squadron. You can't take them on their own. All the light cruisers are like that. So they have a different purpose in missions and list building. Then you've got... Oh, sorry, you were going to say?
Well, that's the thing that people are going to find once this game actually lands. You're going to have to learn a whole new type of warfare. Because, you know, Drop Zone Commander, we know it's, you know, tactical teams on the ground, complete objectives. This is a very different type of beast once you actually start playing bigger games. The feel of game is going to be a lot different.
Yeah, it's more strategic, and there's two games going on, the ground and the orbit, and there's the links between them, but they're quite sort of...
Exactly, you know, so learning the tactics is going to be very interesting for this one.
Then we have the other offensive PHR heavy cruiser, the Achilles. The Achilles is quite different. For one, it's the only cruiser in only cruiser-sized ship in the game with a torpedo, which is externally mounted out here, like other PHR torpedoes. Yeah. Just the one. So once it's gone, it's gone.
Yeah. If there's something that has to die, it's going to die.
Yep. And the Achilles also has... They're actually... You can see them from the front. The heavy mass drivers are so big that they stick out from the ship. They're actually poseable. They're all independently positionable, which is cool. Heavy mass drivers, again, battleship killers, battlecruiser killers. So this is actually out there to kill ships bigger than itself, which is cool. Very specialist. The Achilles is much more specialist than the Hector, which is much more all-round. So again, depends what else you've taken, you know.
Yeah, it's very much a tool for job sort of situation. You know, if let's say we have the arms race, which always happens with the game once you get on the table. Say John knows that my next purchase is going to be a battleship. He could be playing PHR and think, right, well, I don't want to have to go for a battleship just yet, so let's grab one of these, see how it does.
I'll throw a couple of Achilles in just to have a look at what they can do.
Yeah, you know, I mean, if it depends on the meta as well, which, weirdly, we don't know what the meta's going to be. I mean, we think we know, but gamers are gamers, and once they've had some time with the system, you know, if the meta is battleship heavy, if it's like take two battleships, then that Achilles is going to be a really powerful ship to take. You know, if no one's taking big ships for some reason, they won't, I don't think, because big ships are amazing.
Too cool.
You know, but we'll see how that goes. Yeah. You know, it's an interesting one. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, the frigates, people have seen those before, so I won't spend time on the frigates, but they were there for scale to show you the rest of the fleet.
Yeah. Right, Sheltari, you have some ships from them that haven't been seen yet.
Yeah, there are a few people who have seen most of them, but these are the last, these are the stragglers, I'd call it, the last few ships that we've not seen before. So we have
the last of the fleet has now arrived.
Yep.
So let's see.
So we've got the two missing frigates.
All right.
Which is the Amethyst, which is this one here, and the Opal, which is this one here. The Amethyst is an interesting one. The Sheltari have generally the worst close action weapons in the game. They're not random generally. Most other factions' close actions are like D6 plus one or D3 plus two. These are just fixed at like three. So you know how many dice you're going to get, but you're not going to get that many. They're not a close action faction. If you're going to get close with the Sheltari, generally, bad idea, you're going to die.
So basically, if someone's charging headlong at you, turn the other way.
Yeah, but the Amethyst is an exception.
Okay.
This is the best close action frigate in the game.
Right.
Also the most expensive. So in the fleet, it's a real, like, specific thing. You know, it's hyper-aggressive, fast, because it's Sheltari. It's the longest range close action because it's Sheltari, so it's got an excellent scan range. So you can hit them before they can hit you back with close action, and it has a ton of dice. This has a microwave cannon array.
Right.
In the background, this does all sorts of nasty things. Melts hull, boils the blood of the crew through the hull. So all kinds of nasty, horrible visuals for this ship. Tons of dice. I can't remember exactly how many off the top of my head, but it's the most powerful close action frigate in the game. Scared.
Is it an excellent little escort ship then to have flying around something else just to keep it a little
Not safer? Really, because you don't want anything else where this is. It's you could if you were going to be ultra aggressive with Sheltari, which is not, I think, the best way to play the faction. These are good flankers. They're good flankers, and they're good, I'd like to think of them as assassins. For things like enemy carriers that are going to be sat at the back. Yeah, you could shoot them, but you could send these after them. And these are going to make that kill, and they're fast, and they're expensive, but they're not that expensive. So you could take a few of them, flank, that kind of thing. Good at killing other enemy flanking units that are trying to do the same to you.
Cool.
You know, cool, very specialist. The other one is also specialist, the Opal. This thing boosts your shields. This is your escort ship. This one here.
Okay.
This has basically no guns to speak of. It's more or less unarmed. It's got the rubbish Sheltari close action weapons. That's it. But what it does do is boost your save once per ship per turn. So you put this next to a battleship, and an enemy battleship fires on it with everything it's got, and you're going to get to basically get bonuses on a ton of saves, and it's going to be a really powerful effect.
Yeah.
If you use it on a frigate firing another frigate, well, okay.
Bit of a waste.
Yeah. So, you know, these are good escorts for your most expensive ships in your fleet.
So basically the big Sheltari supercarrier, put one of those next to it.
Yep. And especially the Diamond-class, the battleship, because it's going to probably be further forward and likely to get shot at more.
Yeah.
So that's where this thing has a purpose. Very specific, but excellent escort ship.
Cool. Now, I do see we have some images here. I'm not sure of what they are of. So what is
Oh, yeah,
this?
So there's the Opal.
That's the Opal.
That's the Opal. Yeah. You can see all the shield-boosting structures on the crest there. That's what they are.
Yeah, then moving along.
That's the Amethyst there. Mm-hmm. You see all the little microwave cannons around the front?
Yeah,
they'll be familiar for anyone who plays Drop Zone. It's the same thing, just writ large.
Yeah. next up, what is this?
So this is the Basalt class fleet carrier. This is the Sheltari's standard fleet.
One?
We have one here.
Okay.
Yeah. This is the Sheltari's standard fleet carrier.
Mm-hmm.
You've got two disruptors at the front. Disruptors are standard guns, but they're front narrow and they're a little bit weaker than the normal front guns that you'd expect to get on a Sheltari ship. But it has these structures at the back. You can probably see them better on the screen, actually. These here.
Coming out from the inner core, I'm guessing?
Yeah. Yeah, those two kind of blocks at the back. That's your launch bays for your fighters and bombers. And much like the supercarrier, you know, Sheltari fighters are stunningly good.
Mm.
So you need them for protecting your ships from close action if your shields are up. And obviously it's great for bombers, because bombers are very powerful as well. It's got a good launch capacity because its guns are a bit rubbish.
Mm-hmm.
So dedicated carrier.
Awesome. Right, our next one. What is this?
This is the Azurai. I always get these the wrong way around.
So this is the Azurai?
Yeah, this one. The Sheltari light cruiser, one of the two light cruisers. The Amethyst is the...
This one?
Know, yeah, that's the other one. That's got disruptors at the front. This thing is... It's not that powerful. The one with disruptors is quite cheap, fast. All Sheltari light cruisers have the extra rule that they can turn faster than any other ship in the game.
Yeah, right.
So the front narrow thing isn't really an issue because you can just turn on a dime, which is really powerful. Great if you want to get behind enemy ships, which is what they're good for, and they're cheap and very fast. This one, the weirder one, has the gravity coils at the front. Okay. I love these weapons.
It's a very sleek looking machine.
Yes, it's really thin. Yeah. So it's vertically mounted. So you can build, it's worth mentioning, of course, you can build all these ships from the standard sprue.
Yeah,
so
the
standard Sheltari cruiser sprue will make any of these ships. You know, you make the fleet carrier, you make the light cruiser, heavy cruiser, whatever.
Mm.
You can mix and match. This thing, it's the same parts, but vertically mounted with a different core. And a little mount point for the flight stand, which needs to be added. And they're offset too, so it's not, you know, I had fun sculpting this one because it looks so different from the other ships and yet uses a lot of
the same parts.
Yeah. It looks racy.
Yeah, it's racy because it is.
It's the only way to describe it. It looks racy. It looks as if it's a little speedster.
Yeah, and has probably the most interestingly odd weapon in the game, which is the gravity coils.
Okay, what does that do?
Gravity coils, they project a tunnel of highly confused gravity. So they'll have basically have a ship crush itself under its own weight, or have parts drift apart. There's all sorts of odd gravitational effects.
Right.
So that does damage. That's nice. But the real thing it does is it actually affects the enemy's path. So you can use it to turn an enemy ship. Which is, that's tactically, this is what this ship does.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah, again, on something like a battleship, especially when it's got front narrow weapons, like that big PHR one earlier,
just
if you can
nudge
it out the way. Yeah, really irritating.
Okay, guys, Sheltari, I'm calling movement shenanigans right now.
Yeah, Sheltari are all about shenanigans anyway. That's a big part of the faction, but this is the most shenanigan-y ship that they have.
Shenanigan-y ship. That's a word now.
It's a fun one, and it obviously makes opponents swear a lot.
I can imagine.
You don't want to take too many of them because they're not that cheap, and the damage dealing capacity is not marvellous. So,
maybe so, but even having two of them in a large game, say you were going to a tournament, two of those, being able to mess with your opponent's movement is really going to screw up their battle plans.
This is close action as well, the gravity coils. So worth mentioning. So you've got to be close to do it. You're not going to do it from... And also, actually, the other cool thing I didn't mention about that close action frigate we talked about earlier, the Amethyst, The cool thing about that is the close action weapons it has are beam close action weapons. Both of these are.
Right.
What that means is that the enemy doesn't get any point defense against them.
Ah,
there's no blocking it because it's a beam.
Yeah.
So that's cool for both of these ships. Mm. But yeah, close action. And with Shaltari, that's hard to bring to bear without dying in the process. Mm. So it's a powerful effect, but you've just got to be careful with it.
Well, very interesting. Okay, guys, I want comments below. What do you think of the new tricks that are coming out of Shaltari here?
So we're going to get some hate. it's a fun one. It's been in the Admiral demos and everything. And it's been fun, but it's not caused like terrible carnage. And we've playtested like take loads of these and see what happens, and it's fine. It's, you know, it's cool ship.
All right. Well, the next thing we have to talk about, I've got some art in here, so if we want to go through that. So this is some of the actual ships in orbit around planets.
Yeah, so there is a ton of artwork for Dropfleet. We're only going to show a small amount of it here, but the book has been underway for some time. Artwork, there's a lot of content in there as well. There's just a few samples.
It's nice seeing them in position. It's giving you that grounding of what you're
Giving you a sense. This is one worth stopping on.
Okay.
And this is the core in a Shaltari ship. The core is their equivalent of the bridge. Small crew, only like a couple of Shaltari in there. Mm. And it's just a mess of visuals, and you know, a human being would get a headache within seconds of being in there. Yeah. You know, but the Shaltari are directing it all, you know.
It's really, quite simply, just sitting there playing with the light going, "We got this." Next up, what
Very
is
alien.
This?
Oh, this is this one, people have seen this small before. Mm. This one's a boarding party on an old space station orbital, because a lot of the orbitals are old by this point. They're 200 years old. This guy probably died during the original Scourge invasion, and that mouldering skeleton's been there for 162 years before being boarded by these guys. Mm. Orbitals are a big part of things. Obviously, there's the space station pack, which we're still finishing the sprue for. But people have seen those before, so they know what they're dealing with it.
Well, I mean, like, I suppose that is one of the things you would expect with the UCM taking back the Cradle Worlds, is that they are going to want to take everything back. So if they can get one of these old stations up and online again, that gives them a power base to actually, you know, store supplies in orbit and then transport them
and
down.
And some of the mission, you can capture them, and they have weapons. Mm. Some of the orbitals, you know, the Scourge, they've used the ones that they consider useful, and the rest of them, they've either cannibalized the metal or they've just let them rot.
Aye.
But they took like over 100 years to build most of these orbitals, and they're huge things. So, you know, the Scourge don't waste what they capture. They keep it and use it for the most part. So this might be a recreational area on that orbital that the Scourge don't care about, and they've just left it.
And what's this last
thing? This is the heavy hazard suit in its original habitat.
Ah, I see.
The one that gets armed with railguns in Drop Zone Commander.
Aye.
This is the original use for the suits, which is things like aboard spaceships for repairs, for orbital spacewalks, that kind of thing. You know, obviously completely sealed from the void.
Yeah. So basically, if it's somewhere you don't want to go to fix it, grab one of these.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the artwork in the book is more human, because you know, there's a lot of images of spaceships, you know, but these ships are small cities, you know, they're full of living people and, you know, living their lives, and that's, I try and bring the human side home a lot of the time, and the artwork is great for that.
Well, then, like, the main cast from this story sort of seems to come from the human side of things. You seem to see it coming from humanity coming back.
Yeah, it's told from the human's perspective too. I mean, this is worth segueing into the background for Dropfleet, actually, because I've almost finished writing it. I've got out of about 55,000 words, I've got about 4,000 left to write. So just the last few little snippets that have got to be dropped in, which I'm writing this weekend. So I will be done very imminently on that. But yeah, so there's another, you know, third of a novel's worth of background in the Dropfleet book. Intentionally as well, it's designed so you could read it if you're not familiar with the universe. So if you back the Kickstarter, you've not played Drop Zone, you could just get that book, and that'll get you a sense of what you're dealing with, what the factions are like, what their purposes are. You know, it'll tell you, as a Drop Zone player, though, it's set 100 days after Reconquest Phase 2. Mm-hmm. So it's the most recent book in the storyline. Reconquest Phase 2 out at the end of July. Mm-hmm. Then this is out, obviously, later in the year, so it's going to follow on. Mm-hmm. Every book we release will be the most recent in the timeline.
So you're continuing the story with
And the timeline grows as it goes along.
Yeah.
So there's more reveals in this, and, you know, if you're playing Dropfleet and you're not playing Drop Zone, there's a lot of extra background in the Drop Zone books that pertain to Dropfleet.
Well, I mean, the two games seem to interweave together very nicely at the moment, so it's going to be interesting to see how people play on that for even campaigns and stuff in the future. But, right, there's one last thing I want to get a look at.
Venture into the dangerous dungeons of Myth as a mighty hero and stand against the darkness. Visit the Myth Hub on beastofwar.com and begin your story. Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastofwar.com.
Those miniatures, if you're into your spaceships,
yeah,
I don't think anybody has nailed spaceships better than Dropfleet.
Myself and John are just sitting, jumping at the bit to get our forces in.
If you're interested in learning the rest of that and seeing the actual sprues, remember to come on over to Beast of War, take up a backstage account, and we've got the sprue analysis in tomorrow's show. Right, before we wrap it up, I do have one Kickstarter I want to tell you about.
Okay.
This one's from Antonosity's Workshop, okay? Mm. And it's the Fast Panda Mobile Pizza Truck, okay? Think I'm mad, this is one of the best things I've seen in ages. So it's designed for Infinity. Mm-hmm. It's 28 millimeter scale, okay? And what it is it's like a futuristic mobile restaurant. How cool is that?
I like this idea. I like the idea
You go down to the scale stuff, scroll back up, right? Yeah. So this is the concept art, okay? Yeah. Scroll back up a bit more.
Yeah.
So that's it all closed up, right?
Yeah.
Tell me that is not one of the best sci-fi designs you've seen in ages. I just love where they're going with this. You know, some of the guys that are doing the stuff for Infinity just have this amazing...
They have the vibe for the world.
Yeah, and they have this amazing feel for what the future might be like.
Yeah.
You know, it's, the only thing I can describe this as, right, was a few months back, I'm deviating from the running order again. A few months back, I was showing these guys an animation that had cropped up of the Chinese were building a super wide bus.
Oh yeah,
that was on stilts.
That's rolled out now.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, they've done
and
it. Yeah,
the bus moved up and down the road on these kind of track stilts and moved over the top of traffic.
Yeah.
Okay. 8 months later, they've it built.
Yeah.
And functioning. It's like it's the most sci-fi thing I've ever seen in real life. I think it's incredibly clever
because it means that you know the buses are always going to be on time now because they're not stuck in traffic
until you want to make a turn.
it's actually quite fascinating when it comes to all this stuff that we're talking about with technology and this Chinese bus thing. If you actually follow the Antonosity Workshop Facebook, they put a lot of these stories up on their page.
Yeah.
And then slowly you'll see some of these models coming through into their range over time.
Yeah.
So it's great to just go, right, well, that's probably coming out in a couple of months or something. So it's very cool.
Well, bring it back up there to have a look through the rest of it. So I said all closed up and moving.
Yeah,
it then opens up and you have the whole canopy and your restaurant area where you can kind of sit down. Tell me that's not the coolest thing.
And I want even to the see front opens up like to that. Give you a little vending machine for your drinks.
Uh-huh. Isn't it just
it's
stunning?
Really, really cool.
Okay, further down the page, he shows scale stuff. So what they did was they printed out a boxed model to try and give you a sense of scale.
Yeah, now I like the idea that it's big enough to actually hide a tag behind.
Yes.
Because that is something that some people struggle with sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
But it just looks fantastic. It looks as if it's going to be a great little piece to lay down in the middle of your table. You know, I hope they do the both versions, open and closed.
They will. You know, it's I think what it does, it'll come with extra parts that you can then set it up as open. In fact, if you scroll down, you actually start to see the individual parts that are there. So you've got the till, they've got the ramp, the vending machine, the menu boards, the awning.
Couple of different layers of seating.
And then if
there.
You go down a bit further, keep going down, you'll actually see some of the individual components.
Ah!
So these are the parts that it'll actually come in.
Mm-hmm. Very cool.
It's just genius, isn't it? Yeah. It is just genius.
Ah, now there's something I like to see. You will have the two options because I'm seeing you have the closed canopy at the front and the open canopy at the front. Mm-hmm. So you probably will be fit to build this both ways.
Oh, it's going to be magnetizable as well that you can switch in and out.
They've said that when you get the standard pledge for this, you'll be able to choose whether or not you want it open and closed as well and change it around and stuff like that. So you can pick how you want to put it down onto the table, really.
Very cool. Yeah. Very good pick, Warren.
The other thing that I was really cool, was really thinking about this as well, is obviously we've talked about it from a sort of more sort of Infinity standpoint, and with it being sort of nice and clean looking and stuff like that. It's also got a very much a Blade Runner vibe to it as well, and I'd love to see it with sort of, you know, a bit sort of dirtier and a bit sort of grimier as well, and sort of maybe a bit sort of seedy, maybe, and sort of tucked away somewhere in a strange part of the board somewhere. I think it'd be really cool and sort of add to the narrative in that strange way too.
If it's painted up in camo pattern, right? Mobile mobile canteen for your soldiers.
Yeah. Possibly.
Yeah. You know, possibly. I can totally see that painted up in my Imperial Guard colors with the camo patterns and stuff like that there. Men got to eat, and ladies. Everybody got to eat.
What's the main deployment area over in Iraq? Fort Bastion, isn't it? Mm-hmm. They actually have two shipping containers I saw in an image over there.
That were converted into Burger King and
No, it was
McDonald's
Pizza Hut and Subway I saw.
Yeah. But that's how they do it. You know, all those big corporations are in those, they are active in those war zones.
Yeah.
So you will have like drop-in Subways, drop-in Pizza Huts and stuff like that.
So
because
the troops want to eat the food
from home.
Yeah, yeah. And it makes a lot of sense that you would have something like this would be a perfect thing for doing that.
Wouldn't
in Infinity. So,
yeah, but even beyond Infinity. You know, Warpath, any of the big sci-fi military games that we're playing,
right?
You know, you just get one, you do it up, and you've got a mobile canteen.
All right, well,
sitting in your military base.
There's an idea for your scatter terrain. Somebody design us up, you know, war zone restaurants.
War zone restaurants for the scatter terrain challenge. Yeah.
You know, just call it War Zone's Burgers.
They need to be big. Okay, look, thank you very much for joining us. We have a bumper show for our backstagers tomorrow morning. We've got tons of really, really interesting stuff to talk about. So if you're interested, once again, consider coming on over and joining Backstage. The Backstage contributions are what allow us to do everything. So anything that you're watching now has only been made possible by the contributions of our Backstagers. So if we didn't have the Backstagers, there would be nothing. There would be no website. There would be no content. There would be nothing. So if you do enjoy what we do and enjoy the stuff that's coming out for free, do consider maybe coming across, joining Backstage, because that's a massive help to us to be able to create not just Backstage content, but this very stuff that's all going out front stage as well. Right. Thank you, gentlemen. That was a morning well spent. And hopefully we'll see as many of you as possible over at beastsofwar.com tomorrow morning, where we've got a doozy of a show lined up for you.
In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your Megacon to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastsofwar.com. Keep your blaster handy. The West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastsofwar.com.